Assalamualaikum and welcome to the Munir Muhammad Show. We are streaming live. Brothers and sisters, I'm so excited about today's show. But before we get into it, I want to remind you that you can follow us on social media platforms on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. And please go to our YouTube page and click on that subscribe button so you can be notified whenever we are on the air. Brothers and sisters, I am excited about my next guest. She's a freshman alderman, hailed from the 20th Ward. You know, we have Alderman Jeanette Taylor. How are you, sister?
I'm good, brother. How are you?
I'm well. Thank you. You know, I'm smiling because, you know, we have such good conversation, and I know it's cliche, but you keep it real.
I don't think I have a choice.
Right, right.
I think how I got here, being just honest and blunt.
Well, that's good. And we need honesty, transparency, and all of those things. You have an awesome responsibility. I know you a little over a year now in your office. So many things have happened that I'm sure you couldn't have predicted.
Not at all.
But, you know, you were selected by the people for a reason.
So, definitely was. Yeah, we're in two different pandemics.
Yeah.
So we got COVID-19 and racism, and that one has always existed. And so I didn't really get to celebrate a year like I would have, but I'm learning, and I wouldn't take it back.
Yes, ma'am. So has it gone by fast, or, I mean, what has it been like?
It has, really fast. Yeah. I looked up and I'm like, it don't seem like it's been a year.
Yeah.
And I think because in the last couple of months, I had these benchmarks that I was supposed to reach.
Yes.
And the universe said something different. And so it gave me an opportunity to kind of reflect back of how to build relationships and how to do government different. And so the 3 months off has not been time off, because you're still working. Yeah. You're still providing services. You're still talking to constituents, and you're still organizing. Yeah. So, and I needed that time.
Yeah.
Like, it was healthy, and it gave me to really realize that to be appreciative of the space that I'm in and to do some things different.
Yes. You know, I want to remind our viewing audience that this show is live. If you'd like to participate, you can give us a call at 773-434-6625. You know, I know the last time you were here was really when the COVID outbreak was happening, and so much has happened since then. You know, primarily, you know, we saw the deaths of Breonna Taylor, George Floyd, Ahmaud Arbery, so many more, the civil unrest that has happened. And really, when you were here, we were talking about how COVID magnified the disparities that already existed. And with the death of George Floyd and others, it magnified again the disparities and injustice that has always existed as well. And so, you know, of course, in Chicago, we saw a lot of protests as a result of, you know, hey, these are the times, the pressures of things that people are dealing with. And being an elected official, being an alderman in particular in that community, tell me, what kind of conversations have you had with constituents, so when they see you or they call you, just about how are they feeling?
So, support. Because you think people have been unemployed for 3 months, and all we really got was $1,200.
Yeah.
So how are we feeding our families? How are we going to get employed? After the looting, how will we rebuild businesses? How will we talk about really recycling our own dollars? People kept saying, you're tearing up your own community. We don't own any of the institutions in our community. So how do we get to that place? How do we rebuild what we own the institutions? How do we make sure people in our community are employed? They can run their own business. How do we combat a lot of these violence? How do we talk about police in our community that's in a healthy way and have honest conversations, and then just address things that we need to do as the Black community? So it's easy for people to look at, you talk about, they always throwing this Black Lives Matter and where they at when it's black on black crime. Do y'all say that to people who do white on white crime or Asian on Asian crime? It's just to us, because that's the target. And if you see it on the news, it's, you saw the 1 year old baby, you saw the 3 year old baby, then you saw a 2 year old. And it's like, that's been happening for years and it doesn't make it right, but it makes it means the powers that be, you step back and you listen to what the community has to say and how we fix it. And so what I've been telling my community is, think about this, you got a cat. You can feed that cat, you can give it food, you back it up in the corner, it's gonna come out scratching you and it don't care. And that's what we've saw, this pressure that you saw with the looting. That's been building for years. You can't continue to take our dollars but not invest in our communities. And so I ain't telling nobody to go out and loot, but I understand. 8 minutes and 46 seconds, you saw police officer with his knee on somebody's neck, and you watch the rest of the police force watch. And so why would I trust my life with people who would watch somebody do something wrong? And so it was my biggest problem with Eddie Johnson, saying, I if there's a code of silence, I ain't seen it. Well, unless you Stevie Wonder blind, anybody could see that there's a code of silence. And it's like, the other side of it is, I came from officer friendly. I came from that time when the police didn't see you go to school, they put you in the car and took you to school, then met you at home, tell your mama, and you got a whooping. That's not what young people see today. And so think about police officers who see killings every day. Where's the mental health for them? Police officers that need a mental break. We don't talk about the suicide within the police, because it happens a lot. It's just not talked about. And so until we're able to have these honest conversations with each other and address it, we just, we gonna do the same thing over and over again. And that's just not, I'm not here for that reason. I'm here for us to have those hard conversations. I'm here to say, I might not like you, but let's work together. And that's the lesson that COVID should have taught us. And that's what will get this country on its way to repair what has been stolen from Black folks.
You said it well, and it takes me back to when I was younger. There were a few police officers that were more interested in teaching us a lesson. Like, when I do something, explain the consequence, but you know, you got to move on. Of course, we had other experiences that were different, but now it seems overwhelmingly the whole culture has changed, and it's bigger than just policing. It's one thing that I've been sharing and repeating on this show, that even if policing was perfect, Black people still suffer injustices in every other aspect of society, you know. And so we're talking just on the topic of policing. You know, we have our superintendent who's new, you know, and, you know, something feels like, man, you know, I know he had to know what he was walking into, but all of this is here. But look,
I don't think
it's, I mean, and that's the thing. You know, I know we've had his experiences in Dallas and he's here now. But with this pressure cooker, as you said, when you think about all the pressure that people have been under anyway.
That's right.
And then you had a shelter in place order where people had already been home. Okay. People unemployed. They're worried about, you know, how am I going to pay my rent, my mortgage, my family? Where can I go? All of these things just building.
And homelessness.
Homelessness as well. You're right. And so here you go. It's almost like the perfect storm. And to see how people quickly just shifted the narrative as if people were protesting, looting, whatever you want to call it, but there was no cause behind the effect. You know, and that's what I'm saying, is that I'm not going to condemn anyone for how they respond. I empathize with those business owners, especially in our community, who lost business and things like that. I understand that. But the result, that outcome, something happened to go into that.
It's, we're always putting that Band-Aid on a bullet wound. Yes. And so let's have an honest conversation. The police were never invented to protect black people anyway. Yes. Let's call this what it is. That's number one. Number two, all the training in the world cannot retrain racism. When you're taught to hate, it's a movie called The Hate You Give. You get it back. And so the hate that's given to us now, you see it in disrespect. You see it. I always struggle with the piece where the mayor walked up to the playground and she addressed the young man. She didn't say hi. She didn't say how you doing. She didn't do any of those things. She went into why you're not at home. How do you know I have a home to go to? How do you know I don't live in one of those spaces where my family says, okay, I'm going to work. You got to get out. And when I get back, you can come back. We don't know all these things because we ain't having those conversations. We're just dictating. And dictatorship is not working for us in this country. It never has. And so let's get to the root cause of what's going on in this community. The people who need to police our communities need to look like us, and they need to come from our communities, period. Ain't no ifs, ands, and buts about it. I knew Officer Randy. I knew the twins. I knew a bunch of the police that lived in my community. So when something happened, I would run to them. I can't call the police now and say, hey, they doing A, B, and C. Because when they get out the car, the first thing they'll say is, Alderman Taylor called and said you're doing A, B, and C. So you think I'm a tell, but then we go with this no snitching. Why I'm a tell if I ain't gonna be protected? My first year in office, my first couple of months in office were very harsh because I had two young people under the age of 20 get killed. One was a young man, 13, Donald Williams, was shot by another teenager in his back. And his father struggles with that, and I hurt for him. Another young lady who testified some years ago that somebody killed her cousin, and they got somebody to come get her. She wasn't protected. And so we're protecting shooters because we know what happens when we tell. We know. But you won't address that. You'll just say, we got to do something about this. These black brothers killing other black brothers, and y'all ain't doing nothing about it. No, this is a system y'all created.
And it's not a system that was created, but it's a system that they model within. I mean, and so that's the hypocrisy about it, and it's known. We know that, and so that's a point of it too. Let me ask you this: there's been a lot of conversation around the narrative, the broad narrative of just saying defund the police, and we know that a more appropriate thing might be to divest and reappropriate certain things and responsibilities. And so, talk a little bit about that because. One of the things, and I'll just say this, you know, I believe and understand that black lives matter. When I say that, I mean you, me, you, whoever. As far as the cliche commercialization of it that's becoming, you know, where there's Amazon now, all of a sudden every company say Black Lives Matter, which they wouldn't ever say a month or two ago. They can miss me with that. That doesn't move me at all. So when I talk, let's talk about police reform. Well, defunding the police, because a lot of people, the narrative would be like, okay, well, we don't want police at all and things like that. And we know that we have greater context to that. So talk about that.
Yeah, so it really means to divest in police. We put so much money. Just think about this. The police budget takes up 40% of the city budget. So that's more than we put in housing. That's more than we put in education. That's more than we put in mental health. That's more than we put in public health. And so the stuff that actually works in our communities, you put no money in. But the one thing that militarizes us and mistreats us, we're putting billions of dollars in. And we're not even talking about the lawsuits. There are millions and millions of dollars of lawsuits for police conduct. And so let's talk about it. If you take that money and you put it into these programs and you put it into us having places to live and you put it in employment, you'll have what we had in the 80s and 90s. These communities where it didn't matter who you are, what you did for a living, you could pay your bills, you could take care of your kids, and we can all live as one. That's not what this system is. And let's have the honest conversation about who is employed at the police station. Look at those dynamics. It's not us. And so anytime you're talking about taking dollars from a certain group, then oh, we can't do that. But that's not that, but that's an unequal and an unfair system that we won't even address. It's the same thing when it comes to businesses and construction. You don't see us. I can go in my neighborhood right now and I can count on one hand how many folks look like me on those construction sites. You're forcing me to deal with the dark side. Mm-hmm. You forcing me into selling drugs. You forcing me into prostitution, because at the end of the day, as a black woman, as a black mother, mm-hmm. I'm going to do what I need to do to feed my family. Right. And that's the system that they've created that they won't address. Mm-hmm. And so divesting in the police. Now, I ain't ready to get rid of all the police yet. Right. I ain't there. I'm close, but I ain't there yet. But I'm not going to continue to pay in a system that kills brothers and sisters, brothers that look like me. Yeah. 312-744 comes across my phone. My heart automatically drops. You know why? Because it's either a constituent in my community or it's one of my own. I got three black boys that I'm responsible for. Mm-hmm. And I shouldn't have to give them the talk of don't raise your hand up. Don't talk too loud. Don't do this. Don't be human is what I'm telling them. That's not a conversation I should have. And so when you start talking about divesting, people change behavior. The only thing oppression understands is they missing dollars. They don't care about me crying as a black mother. They don't care about us on the street protesting. Start talking Black Lives Matter to Amazon because our black dollars matter.
Exactly.
That's what they care about. Oh, I'm clear. And I hope everybody else is clear. Mm-hmm. It's about, we're a $1 trillion spending industry. We don't save no money. We spend it every chance we get because we like things and we can. Mm-hmm. And we don't leave nothing. Rarely do we. Because we don't care about that. We it is what it is. We try to live comfortably. That's what you care about talking about Black Lives Matter. Mm-hmm. And we cannot, when people want to change the policies that are in place. Mm-hmm. And so one of the things I said when I first got into office is, and one of the reasons why I ran, because we create policy to help one set of folks, but it hurts another. We can make policy that doesn't do either. We can make policy that helps everybody across every spectrum. And we got to get out of this eliteness. Mm-hmm. We got too many elite folks. Right. Like, you ain't, I'm no different than you. You put your pants leg on one leg at a time like I do. We got to treat each other stuff. We all stood on somebody else's shoulders to get there. Mm-hmm. And so when it comes to policing, we got to have an honest conversation about what divestment looks like. And then how do we retrain some of those who are, some people are not retrainable.
Yeah.
If you saw a child steal a bag of chips and your mind tells you to shoot at that child, you can't be retrained.
Right.
And the FOP, along with the police board, has got to have those honest conversations. But too often they say nothing happened. That's justifiable. So it's justifiable to put your knee on somebody's neck for 8 minutes and 46 seconds. That's calling out his mother and that's saying I can't breathe.
Let me ask you, because you make a good point. And I talk to, you know, as an elected official with a body of 50 aldermen, and I recognize that each alderman has to represent his constituents, and you have a few aldermen who have heavy police populations.
Mm-hmm.
And some, more so than others, have come across, at least, as very insensitive or tone deaf to the situation, but I'm sure others aren't. What's the conversations like in trying to talk to your colleagues about understanding the plight that you're dealing with?
Some of them you can't. All they care about is protecting their constituency and people, let me make sure I say this correctly so you can hear me and they can hear me. Mm-hmm. People who fund their campaigns.
Yes.
So they're never going to see the wrong. I'm a black and white sister. So whether you right or wrong and we friends or not, I got to be able to tell you you wrong. I got to be able to tell you how I see it. Mm-hmm. But I also want to listen to what you got to say. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times, some of my coworkers don't see it that way. Mm-hmm. I'm okay. All I got to do is count to 26.
Mm-hmm.
We got 20 black aldermen. And a lot of times, we suffer with the same issue. Same thing with the Latino caucus and the Progressive caucus. There are some very good people that I'm proud to sit next to and stand next to. Even if I don't, I got a seatmate. He alderman from the 19th Ward. O'Shea.
Right.
Me and him have very good conversations, blunt, and our politics doesn't agree, but it's not a disrespect to me.
Right.
But I also have some co-workers that I don't never have to speak to ever again in this life, and I'm okay with that. But we got to be able to have that conversation about policy.
Yeah.
Now, we're not going to be friends outside of that, but every last one of us, including the mayor, has to be able to have those conversations and hear each other out and have some compromise. Mm-hmm. There is not enough compromise at City Hall.
Yeah.
That's how I see it.
Do you think, I know there was a new administration, several new aldermen, yourself included, coming in. And I know COVID, you know, prevented, impacted your ability to interact. And, you know, I know you all were there the first part of the, you know, year and everything like that. But I know that these virtual meetings and doing things remotely, a lot of things are lost in translation. It keeps, you know, away from the bond and stuff. And so How has that, you think, affected the need, or whether it's the push for policy or the discussions that need to take place?
It has, because you can't. We on video, and right. So usually when you on video, you can put up your picture, and you're doing stuff, so right. You ain't really listening.
Yes.
Like, if we being honest, yes. You're taking notes. Sometimes I'm hungry, so I'm right. eating. All right. type of stuff is going
right.
on.
Right.
So there is not this opportunity to bond and for us yeah. to have those conversations. Mm-hmm. And what I will say about this administration that I loved in the very beginning is we had all of these briefings. Anything before they even, it even was a conversation to even put in an ordinance, we had these healthy conversations. Mm-hmm. And in a lot of instances, you saw some of the ordinance change
yes.
according to those conversations.
Right.
That's not what's happening now.
Yeah.
And so I don't like it at all. I don't mm-hmm. because you're not able to hear the voice that I'm bringing from my community. It's
right.
like you're choosing which alderman you're working with mm-hmm. or the aldermen that are, you know, in that little bubble or whatever.
Right. Right.
A lot of times it's the chairs.
Yeah.
That's what it is.
Yeah.
And that's kind of where you take your information from instead of being, because it's inconvenient mm-hmm. to get on the phone and have these conversations with all of us.
Right.
And so that's the part that's not fair. Mm-hmm. And it's making mm-hmm. what should be a greater transition and a more progressive city council not, because
yeah.
it's not progressive now at all.
I understand. I think we have a caller, but I want to go back to that point in a second. Caller, you on the air?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Brother, I always love when you have this person. That's the second time I feel it. And she's
right.
made for television, brother.
Yes,
and
sir.
And she comes across as being so very, very real that I just cling to what she said. Going hopping back on from community policing, it was working good in the 90s, mid-90s, when Matt Rodriguez and Terry Hill was the superintendent.
Mm-hmm.
But it they took the joint community police training part out of community policing, and then the police just took over and it went to hell. So it don't work no more. So to restore it, they need to put the joint community and police training together, back together again, and we can move forward with that because it was successful. Thank you, sister. I'm going to hang up and listen. And good.
Thank you.
That was our brother, Emmanuel Omar. And I have to tell you, and I think, and I know you saw the show, and I was talking with the great Alderman Dorothy Tillman, and I was telling off camera about you know your passion and everything, because she's someone who loved her community as well, you
she
know
did.
And his brother was talking about community policing and that aspect and how that was taken out. Let's talk about, we hear all the time about these programs and organizations, violence prevention and things like that. So how do we trace who's getting these funds and exactly what is the program that they're doing? You know, because we're definitely not measuring the results. So
we haven't, because they're not working collectively that I can see.
Mm-hmm.
And so you can't do violence prevention in a community where you're not connected with the police, all the community organizations, and the mm-hmm. elected official of that ward. And too often it doesn't happen.
Mm-hmm.
But that should be. That should be written in stone, where that's part of the contract.
Yeah.
And it's sometimes those little details that we think are common sense
mm-hmm.
that they just don't see.
Right.
It's like, let's just get this organization some money and let them figure it out. No, that's not right. how it works. If you're doing violence prevention in my community, and let's say I'm one of those young people that are struggling,
mm-hmm.
if I don't know you, if you ain't did no outreach, if I've never seen you in the community, you think
right.
I'm going to come talk to you about anything that's going on in my household with
right.
me? No.
Right.
But I might go to the elected official that I see walking the street.
Mm-hmm.
I might go to one of the churches. I might be connected to another community organizations.
Mm-hmm.
And so what we don't have the luxury to do anymore is work in silos.
Yeah.
That's not going to work. There are some people that their personality, it sucks to me.
Mm-hmm.
But for the community that I serve, I am going to work with them, period.
Mm-hmm.
Ain't no ifs, ands, or buts about it. I could go talk up under my breath and mumble later about
mm-hmm.
how you get on my nerve.
Right.
But my job and my response, it is irresponsible for us not, let me say that to the camera, it is irresponsible for us not to work together. The movement will not be able to move if we continue to not put our petty differences to the side and work together.
Yeah. And that's so important, especially when you see the bloodshed that's taking place. And you know, regardless of what narrative there is, these children are our children.
That's right.
And so whatever guidance they don't have, that was our responsibility.
That's right.
And so, you know, I don't like when people just discard them as if they popped up out of nowhere, you know.
No,
they are. And they're ours. And so, you know, that's one of the things that even with this, you see a climate. We know that there's dissatisfaction, mm-hmm. but you see a climate, at least a spirit of people desiring to want to work together and talk and interact and begin to pool their resources. However, we have to capitalize on that. And as a elected official, and I know the Black Caucus has been having discussions because, you know, we all have been impacted, whether it's the spirit of COVID mm-hmm. and all of this is taking place. And, you know, I've seen different aldermen, whether they're out in the community and things of that nature. But as a caucus, I mean, strategically, I know that you all identifying and seeing some things, but are you all looking to work together, whether
of
it's...
Of course.
And talk a little bit about that.
So it's
that.
A work in progress. Yes. So, of course, you know the caucus chair mm-hmm. is Jason Irvin. Mm-hmm. The vice chair is Stephanie Coleman,
right.
who is a rookie.
Yes.
So... Those are interesting dynamics, but you got to think of 400 years of mess mm-hmm. and programming and different mayors picking and choosing. Now us starting to get together,
right.
it's going to take some work.
Right.
And you say, well, we ain't got time for that. We going to have to make time for it.
Right.
And so one of the things that just happened, we had a conversation with Streets and Sand because a lot of communities on the South and West Side have more vacant lots and grass than mm-hmm. others. And so trying to figure out how do we make sure that people from our community get the contracts when the contract is up so that we can cut and clean our own communities. Because mm-hmm. in this contract that's now, all they're required to do is cut. And so mm-hmm. you got to wait for the Streets and Sand groups to come back and clean up. And so 3 or 4 days, the community sitting nasty. They're like, well, thank you right. for cutting the grass.
Right.
But it's trash everywhere.
Right.
Those are the type of, we're working on stuff like that.
Yeah.
You saw the first time we had 16 mm-hmm. No votes for marijuana. And so yeah. we're starting.
Right,
it,
right.
And it's a work in progress. I'm grateful for that mm-hmm. body because you got some folks who say whatever they want to say mm-hmm. and they vote the right way
yeah.
and they do what they're supposed to do. You got some folks that are not sure and then you got some folks are trying to learn.
Right.
And so it's a bunch of, it's 20 of us.
It's an interesting dynamic.
It's like your,
right.
It's like your mama and her siblings
right.
or you and your first cousins.
Right. Right.
Like y'all love each other mm-hmm. and y'all come from the same camp,
right.
but y'all got some different dynamics.
Right.
Y'all got some different ways of thinking. And mm-hmm. so we working it out and I'm grateful for the struggle. Sometimes I be like, Lord Jesus, I picked this job.
Mm-hmm.
But then it's other days that I hear, like Alderwoman Leslie Harrison, she testified about mm-hmm. George Floyd
mm-hmm.
and gave a speech about our co-workers making fun of Bobby Rush and that type of thing.
Right.
It touched me because she's been there 20-something years.
Mm-hmm.
She's earned the right to say what she say. Now, if I don't agree with her own policy, that's what
right.
it is. We keep moving. She's also the head of the Women's Caucus,
mm-hmm.
which we're giving away diapers and babies. So it's a bunch of different dynamics
right.
that I like. And I'm able to go and have a conversation with
right.
all of them, which is another thing.
Yeah.
So that's the good part about
yeah.
it. The bad part about it is our people really ain't giving us that time to do that. It's
right.
like, what's the answer now? Fix it
right.
now. You can't fix what's been happening
right.
for centuries.
Yeah.
We can't fix it overnight. And so it's like, work with us and give us that time to do that.
And I think that's what you build on because I have the privilege of working with and being familiar with a lot of the elected officials and understand everything they bring to the table as individuals and collectively, but it doesn't always get to translate into how you get the support from the community, because I know people want what they want, but it's a process to
it
things.
Is.
And I think the engagement of the community has to be more consistent. So what can we begin to do that? I think the desire is there now. Of course,
mm-hmm.
COVID is still real, still impacting things, and it's hard to do that. But what steps can we do to maybe either keep the community more engaged or educated in these processes so they'll know how to support? Because I'll tell you, it's certain groups and certain topics. I remember the first Zoom meeting you had, one of the first you had, and I don't know this company, but I think it had to affect something in either the 43rd Ward.
You're talking about the iron company.
Yes. And I mean, they were lined up, you know, calling back to back. we need, or I would like to see, for issues pertaining to our community, things that you all champion as black elected officials, the community to come out and support in that same way?
When I first got there, my thought was us to have this Chicago black address. Mm-hmm. And so the thing that they did in Atlanta, mm-hmm. maybe 10 years ago, where they had Dick Gregory, they had all these black mm-hmm. electors talking about the things that we should do, but it was also more so about the input from the community. We're going to have to do that.
Yeah.
We're going to have these conversations about who is who in our community, and we got to not make it a competition.
Yeah.
We got to make it about we're listening to the people who we're supposed to represent and sometimes doing the stuff that we don't like. Because some of us have different lived experience.
Yes.
I'm a broke girl. I've been broke my whole life. I got a little extra dollars, but I ain't no different
right.
than the mama who got to go around the corner.
Right.
Like, I'm going to go around the corner, too. Yeah. I've just got a few more dollars than she got, but right. I ain't better than her.
Right.
We got to get all of that stuff out of the yeah. way. We got to get, I'm an elected official.
Yeah.
And as easy as you got it, as easy you could be taken right. away. And we got to be able to say, what was your performance? What did your vote look like? Versus you sweet to me, you give me turkeys, you give me hams, you right. nice, so I'm keep voting for you. No, what did they do that helps your life?
Right.
Did they put policies in place? Did they put the people in front of you to get you and your family employed? Did they hold a bad landlord accountable? Did they hold a city entity accountable for something that they did in right. the war? That's what we got to do, right. not this fluff.
Right.
I got real flack because I wasn't giving out turkeys. And I'm like, I'm going to give you what I'm supposed to give you. And that's service. And that's what you deserve from this city because you pay your taxes. I ain't got no turkeys. And I ain't interested in giving you none either. But that's because right. this position has gotten so watered down.
Right.
And we felt powerless because it hasn't been a lot of folks right. that look like us. Right. It's hard being a black woman in city council. And right. I just got there. Yeah. It's hard being a black woman. Mm-hmm. You ain't respected. And if you speak too much, you mm-hmm. angry, you mm-hmm. all of that. But I'm at a stage in my life which I kept asking God, why you couldn't give me this when I was 25?
Right.
At 25, I would have exploded. At right. 45, I know how to say what I need to say to you and keep it moving and not right. take it personal.
Right.
And so there definitely is some different dynamics. But what did we ask electeds for? Mm-hmm. I give people my personal cell number. Mm-hmm. You didn't hire my staff, you hired me. Mm-hmm. So you need to be able to call me and have a conversation with me. But no, I'm going to give you the truth. I'm not going to give you what you need because I want you to vote for me.
Right.
I worry about that in some years.
Right.
Right now, we're married to each other. Mm-hmm. And in this relationship, it's just like a marriage, just some mm-hmm. give and take.
Right.
You're going to give me the information. Mm-hmm. I'm going to take it and I'm going to do my best to right. get what's supposed to be done.
Right.
Now, if it ain't done like that,
right.
you can't be upset with me. You got to give me time and you got to let me know. Like, I get people all the time to call me and say, my lights are out. Mm. And I tell them, you call me every night that the lights are out. Why? Mm-hmm. Because every night that you call me, I'm calling the city to say, right. get them lights on. Well, and
those are street lights she's talking
that's
about
what I'm
being
talking
out.
About
that's
street lights.
Unrelated to anything
yeah,
else.
Yeah, nothing
for those of you who really know. Anyway, go ahead.
Yeah, so every time you calling me, I'm calling the city to make sure the light, and right. I got a good CDOT liaison.
Right.
And so they get on.
Right.
Same thing with the trees and the yeah. grass and streets right. and sand. Even when it comes to construction mm-hmm. In our community,
yeah. mm-hmm.
we outsource a lot of our contracts and people yeah. don't know it.
Right. Right.
And so it's explaining them to that. Mm-hmm. And then it's give me a minute.
Mm-hmm.
And if I don't call you back, call me back.
Right.
And so that's working for me in my community. Yes. They're getting to see that I'm a woman because all I got is my word. I have
and
nothing else.
I'm sure even I know Malcolm X. Whiteside, especially the VEG crew, or the Department of Forestry, I'm sorry. And they could appreciate that direct communication because sometimes so many people got a bad rap for not communicating directly and things get lost.
I can't do that. I look at this as a community organizer. I don't feel like I'm a politician.
Right.
I handle this in a way where we got to have a personal relationship. Mm-hmm. We got to work it out. We're going to do some debating.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to say something you don't like. I'm going to say something I don't like. But at the end, we still should be able to get done what we need to done, okay. get done.
That's so. Right. I think we have a couple of calls, so let's go to the line. Caller, you're on the air. Caller.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam, Sister Marta.
How are you doing today, brother? Good show.
Doing well, thank you, sister.
And greetings to you, Alderman Taylor.
Thank you, sister.
My question to you is two of them, and I hope you can answer them both. Today there was a press conference with Alderman Moore and the Joint Black Caucus,
mm-hmm.
which I didn't know existed.
Yep.
And I did not see you there, and I'm curious as to why you are not a part of that, since we're talking about unity. And also, during not a city council per se meeting, mm-hmm. but Alderman Lopez and the mayor got into it, and mm-hmm. I found him to be extremely disrespectful to her, mm-hmm. and I just want your opinion on that, and I think you're doing a great job. That's all.
Thank you. So I am part of the Joint Caucus. I just didn't make it today. Mm-hmm. We are starting to be, so it's the state, the city, and the county that are black, it's the Joint Caucus.
Gotcha.
So I am a part of it. I just didn't go today for various reasons. One, I was in a car accident yesterday, I need to take a break and decompress from all that's been happening, because it's hard for people to call you and say, I'm trying to feed my kids, and I'm trying to figure it out. And so a lot of this I carry with me, and I don't think people see that. That's number one. There was disrespect back and forth. And so they have a contentious relationship that I quite don't understand, because I don't always agree with Mayor Lori Lightfoot, but I respect her as first being the mayor, as a woman, as a black woman. And so I can't tell you what's going on between them internally, but that's what that was. And so there was some back and forth between both. It wasn't just him disrespecting her. She disrespected him as well. And either way, it wasn't the space for it, and it happened. And so being embarrassed about it, I am, because we could agree to disagree without getting into it with each other. But that's something that's going on between those two. And so, sister, as much as I would like to speak to it, I can't, because that's not the relationship that I have with her. And so I could pick up the phone and call her, and we could kind of debate, and we have conversations. And she knows where I stand with a lot of things. And so I just don't have those issues with, though. But yes, it's never good to see us. And not to say we're supposed to be kumbaya. Right. We can have healthy debate, but we ain't got to cuss at each other. And that happened on both ends.
Yes,
so.
Ma'am. Yes, sister. I think what we're going to do on that is we're going to take a break and come back on the other side. Brothers and sisters, we're going to take a quick break and come back on the other side with more conversation from Alderman Jeanette Taylor. We'll be right back.
It is important, in particular for African Americans, everybody, mm-hmm. but for African Americans, to ensure mm-hmm. that we are counted in this census. It impacts our redistricting. Mm-hmm. It impacts the amount of money that we get. Mm-hmm. And it has a profound impact on educational issues.
Okay.
Socrates said this a long time ago. Mm-hmm. He said, if you always do what you've always done, you're going to always get what you've always got. That's the definition of insanity. But hold on. I got a dearism, too. That means I made it up.
Yes, sir.
In order for you to get something you never had, mm-hmm. you got to do something you never done. And this is where we're at in 2020 with this census. It's time to do some stuff we never done.
Eat and Run Chicken and Fish has the only chicken you can reheat and eat. It's good as mothers and better than the others. It is the chicken even mothers love. We've been serving the community for over 30 years. We cook with 100% vegetable oil and are open 7 days a week, including holidays. We're located at 87th and Hermitage. Contact us at 773-429-1812 for your takeout order, or let us provide all your catering needs. For the best chicken of your life, it's Eat and Run.
Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum, and we are back continuing our conversation. Sister, I know that we've been talking about so much, but I want to give you a chance because you have a large ward. Talk about the boundaries of the 20th Ward.
So yeah. It's Woodlawn, Washington Park, mm-hmm. Back of the Yards, mm-hmm. New City, Inglewood, and Greater Grand Crossing. So it's a lot because, you know, it's based on density.
Yes.
And because we have over 2,000 vacant lots in my ward, there's not a lot of density there. Okay. So it's cut that way to make sure that I have the right amount of representation. And so, of course, once we get the Obama Presidential Center, we're going to have people wanting to come to the community and live there. So I'll eventually get the density and probably be down to maybe two wards, three wards.
So how is, you mentioned Obama Library, how is the conversation going with the community? I know that there was some concerns about that.
We're still in negotiations about around getting more affordable housing and making sure that we help the folks who've owned their homes in the community for years to keep them. Right now, the ordinance that the mayor is proposing, I don't feel like it does enough, but it's a start because we've seen in so many places where investment happens, you displace the very people who've been living there for generation after generation. And so we're trying to figure out just a format to not stop gentrification, but slow it down as much. And so the Presidential Library is probably in its last few negotiations of back and forth, and then we start to talk about how do we get people in our community employed.
Good. Okay, I think we have a caller. Want to go to the line. Caller, you're on the air. Caller, are you there? All right, one more time. Do we have a call on the line?
Hello?
Yes.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Hi, this is Sister Evita.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, sister. Go ahead. You're on the air.
Yes. I just, you know, I wanted to call as a voice of encouragement, the passion that you speak with, and all the work that you're doing. We need to have more aldermen like yourself. And it's just a refreshing to hear somebody with such passion and love to the community.
Thank you.
Thank you, sister.
I need all that encouragement.
Yeah, you know, your enthusiasm, your passion is contagious. And I like to say, you know, people express themselves differently because we have a lot of effective black aldermen. Mm-hmm. I know, as you said, as you come in with a new one, I know that there's been some mentorship, some things,
of
you
course.
Know. And I get especially proud that, you know, when I see you all out in the community, and not just for the cameras and things, but I think that the bond that you begin to develop with the constituents, it reestablishes that connection because such apathy is taking place over the elected system. You know, when despair is prevalent in the community, I don't have confidence in anyone.
And you know, can't blame them.
Right. And so that's it. And so by connecting them to this process and at least fighting for them, because sometimes, you know, you may not be there for the victory, but a good fight to know somebody's on your team.
Oh, most definitely. I get that. I wasn't, like, if you think about 21 people being in a race, then 15, then 9, then 2, and I'm the one. I'm grateful for that opportunity. They could have chose all the other candidates were good candidates.
Yes.
And I was one of the candidates that wasn't born and raised there. And so it was me being honest. It was me, them seeing me at the doors. It was me saying, call me, let's talk it out. Mm-hmm. I want to know what you think. And it's me not changing when I got into office. And so only because of COVID, I haven't been back out door knocking.
Right.
I've done some flyering, but I haven't been able to reconnect. And that's always our summer plan in the office.
Yeah.
The same way that I knocked on your door to get your vote, I need to be coming back out to say, what is it that you need in this ward? Because I'm not the end all, and I don't know it all. Right. I can't have my eyes everywhere. Right. And so it's important that your community is that eye, is that voice. I got a lot of parts of the ward that are very organized, and I got other spaces that need some help. And so you take the part that's really organized, and you let them do what they do best. You take them to that other part of the ward, get to know each other so they can start their own. We got to be able to pass it. I tell it all the time, it's like the black church. The pastor there for 90 years, and he never passes it on. And when the pastor die, it seems like the church falls apart because they didn't pass on those lessons.
Right.
And so I'm not going to do that. To another generation, I'm not going to do that to my community.
All right, good statement. Now we have a caller. Caller, you're on the air.
Assalamu alaikum, Ms. Marta again. I have a quick question in regards to the looting in her ward and how did it impact her, and are any stores that are still closed or not coming back? And I know the congressman's office is, I believe, on the edge, but not necessarily in her ward. What's her opinion of what occurred with the police officers staging inside his office, claiming to be securing it? Thank you.
My opinion about that. They were resting, I'm going to assume. I struggle with this, and let me tell you why. I didn't agree with the looting, but I understood where people were coming from. Like, we ain't eating. All we got was this $1,200 in 3 months, and they looted. I got that. It's insured. That's number one. Number two, I would rather protect your life than worry about some stuff that we can replace. I also struggle because we got to think, while we're talking about divesting in police and we're talking about policing, they are brothers that look like us that are on that force. And so they're getting a double whammy. You're in a system that you know is racist and corrupt, but you also are paid to do a job. And so you stuck in between, I'm mad and I'm angry and I'm hurting with my people, but this is my job. Mm-hmm. And so that's how it was for me with looting. Like, I ain't doing no looting. I ain't buying nothing. I ain't into that, but I understand. And so them being in the office resting, I get it. I think we got bigger fish to fry, and that's not it. That wasn't it. Mm-hmm. Like, they were in the office. Now, the disrespect to the congressman, it has to be dealt with, because whether you like Bobby Rush or not, he is a congressman. He's done his work, and he is who he is. He deserves to be respected. And so in that aspect, we had other things to talk about. And so I didn't indulge in that conversation. It wasn't for me to indulge to, but I definitely didn't appreciate the disrespect we got from other elected officials. That's what I didn't appreciate, and so that's what it was for me. As far as looting, to be honest, I don't have a lot of retail in my ward, but before I could step out of my door, my community was already out cleaning. And so that's who I thank. That's who I'm appreciative for. That's who I'm fighting for, because my community got out, didn't have to say, it's done. Mm-hmm. I didn't have to pick up a phone to call anybody. They were like, we already out here. We're cleaning it up. And a lot of our businesses are coming back. They are. But we also got to have the honest conversation about some places mistreat our people. Mm-hmm. We ain't talk about that. Some businesses weren't touched. Others were. And it's all in how you treat people in your community. Like, we had the real talk about this looting. Right, right. We had the honest conversation. Mm-hmm. Places that were black owned, and if people knew they were black owned, they didn't bother them. Mm-hmm. You know, and as we ain't talked about it's some people that disrespect our young people and our women in our community, and they like, you gonna get what you deserve.
Yeah.
We gotta address it. Whether it's right or wrong, that ain't for me to say, but it happened.
Yeah.
We got to start looking at our own selves in the mirror with a lot of this stuff and not allow outside folks to dictate what we do in our communities. We don't own, let's be honest, we don't own none of the institutions in our community, or we own very little. And so this rebuilding of the city and what is happening, I want it to be rebuilt in our communities where we own the institutions and we recycle wealth. I want to make sure the businesses in my community get those grants. Stop bailing out large corporations and the banks. Bail out the people. Right. That's what I want to see. That's what's important to me.
Right. And I agree. And I'll tell you, especially, you know, and I'll say this as a Muslim follower of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and I don't care who really likes it. Those people who come in our communities under the religion of Islam, but they sell all this stuff to our people. They disrespect and talk to our women in a way that they don't talk to their own.
That's right.
I don't care anything about them. Under any circumstances. So, because if they show more love for their own women, they don't talk to them disrespectfully.
That's right.
They protect their own kind. They don't do certain things that they give off to our people. And so, if they could do it to us, why should I feel any love or sympathy for them? I'm not cut from that cloth. And whether it's burned down clothes or whatever, that's the business. If it's insured, so be it. But as far as a tear being shed for it, no, not at all. So,
mad at you, brother. That's what it is. And we got to think about that. We wouldn't be allowed to even build in that community. We could barely walk in those communities. We could barely go. And so the thought that you're in our community and you can't be respectful, I'm with you on that one.
And so, you know, it doing this. It just, and I don't want to lose this because you started out, I think it was 21 candidates, right? that door knocking, that going through the community, that selling, getting to know the people in the ward, just talk about how that's benefited you and shaped you as you serve that community.
Because they trust that I was going to do they fighting.
Right.
They knew that I wasn't going to go down there and go alone to get along mm-hmm. and not call out stuff that I see or mm-hmm. not challenge the powers that be. I had an elder literally cuss me out because I voted no to mm-hmm. give the mayor ultimate power mm-hmm. to say how this money was spent. Mm-hmm. And I had to explain to her, what was the purpose of you electing me if I'm going to let somebody take the power that's yours, that you've allowed me to use, and right. then do what they want to do. And knowing ultimately that the money is not going to our communities right. as it should.
Yeah.
And so I just had to explain it to her in that way. And she later on called me and apologized and was like, I'm sorry, I didn't see it that way. We got to be able to call out people even if they look like us.
Yeah.
If you wrong, you wrong. And we got to be able to do that. And so it's refreshing to me. Mm-hmm. I go through those days where I'll be like, Lord, why did you do this to me? Why did you put me in a place?
Mm-hmm.
I always get reminded. I get a phone call, I get a text, or something happens where I'm in motion to get it done, mm-hmm. and I'm reminded why I'm here.
Yeah.
And I appreciate those moments. And I knew this wasn't going to be all sprinkles. I didn't think it was going to be that,
right.
but I never would thought in a million years that we'd be in the middle of pandemic and this big thing around racism and us really talking about oppression.
Yeah, it is something. And you, you're right. There's nowhere to plan for it, but it also brings to light the very thing that you were fighting for, the reason you wanted to be in office
mm-hmm.
anyway.
It does. It's mm-hmm. like you wondering why the large number of Black and Latino people are dying, because we don't have access to health care. We mm-hmm. don't have the free clinics anymore.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have vans that come out and give people screenings and things like that. And mm-hmm. so, of course, we're dying mm-hmm. at a higher rate than everybody else, because mm-hmm. we don't have access.
Right.
We got the liquor stores. We mm-hmm. got corner stores that sell flaming hot and juice.
Mm-hmm.
We don't got fresh fruits and vegetables.
Mm-hmm.
I'm in a war where we've had Jules, what, a year? A
yeah.
year and a half, we've yeah. lived in a food, all we had was Aldi's.
Right.
So we've lived in a food desert so long, and that's been allowed to happen.
Mm-hmm.
How is it that people come and profit off the city of Chicago, and you don't tell them, hey, you could come, but this is where you're going to go?
Yeah.
You don't get to choose. See,
right.
we put developers and corporations and businesses and banks before
mm-hmm.
we put the actual people who pay our salaries. And I'm going to say this to you all. Y'all pay our salaries. We work for you. Make us work for you. Some people don't do anything because they ain't asked or they ain't pushed. We need to be asking and pushing people to run our agenda, whatever that is.
Mm-hmm.
And the agenda will change around time.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's no one Black agenda. It's not,
right.
and it ain't one that's all correct that puts everything in. It's a bunch of things
right.
that we need to work on. We need mental health, which is something we don't even talk about. Like,
yeah.
you going to a therapist, that's not nothing we talk about. You,
right.
you'll get a whooping. Come
yeah.
talking about, I'm going to therapy. You
right.
talking about medicine, talking
mm-hmm.
about having a day breather, talking about doing yoga, those type of things. It's like stuff that we got to talk about as Black folks. We need
yeah.
to have our own, in the words of Maze, what's mm-hmm. in it for the Black people, and
right.
what do Black people really need?
Right.
And we need to have them conversations, and they hard. They are hard, from them talking about young people don't have fathers. My father died, had a seizure at our house.
Mm-hmm.
He ain't in my life because he left.
Right.
Because he died. We talking about fathers who was out trying to make a way for their kids and got locked up, or they were wrongly convicted, because
yeah.
that happened with. We don't talk about all those things. We
yeah.
just talk about what you see on the surface.
Yes.
We got to be ready and willing and able to address those underlying issues.
Yes. As a person, I know we're running out of time, but as far as schools in the fall, I know there's a thought
ready.
Of coming in, but I mean, what
we're
it?
Not ready.
Yeah.
Think about this.
Mm-hmm.
In schools on the south and west side, you already got 30 kids in a classroom. You don't have a teacher's assistant.
Yeah.
You're talking about COVID killing mm-hmm. Black and brown folks.
Mm-hmm.
There was this study that talked about young people being the carriers.
Yeah.
And so you're going to have all of this in a classroom with a teacher.
Yes. Right.
That doesn't make common sense.
Right.
And so while we not working with this, and why is CPS not working with CTU and listening?
Yeah. Yeah,
CPS gives more than enough money to listen, and they're not. And I'm so disappointed. I that's another whole segment about my disappointment with CPS because you ain't got it right since the Willis Waggons. You ain't got it right since the first walkout.
Yeah.
And you won't listen. All these years, like I was a teen mother. I had my first baby when I was 15. Mm-hmm. By the time I was 19, I had three kids, and my mother made me get on the LSC because she was on. And even then, they always made me felt like I was wrong. Mm-hmm. Like I wasn't talking with common sense, like the things that I was seeing, oh, that's just other schools don't have it.
Right.
But then I go past CERMAC, and it glitters in gold.
Yeah.
And so all these times that I thought I was wrong when I knew I was right, y'all still not listening.
Yes.
Right. Like the thought that they the CPD out of CPS conversation. Mm-hmm. Why is that even a conversation with all of the incidents that happened? 26,000 incidents since what 2007 up until now.
Mm-hmm.
They ain't even a conversation. Where are the majority of the police in black and brown communities?
Right.
$33 million that we could spend on therapy because our young people see people get killed every day. They see people on drugs every day. They live in communities where they're taught they ain't nothing. No, they're taught that when you're born, you got this target on you. Right. Those are the things that we need.
Right.
You have them in schools for folks that don't look like us. But for when it's us, it's, oh, they strong. They can figure it out.
Hey, you know, they take us for granted and take advantage of us. As we wind down, make sure you tell the people if they want to get in touch with you at your ward office, what can they do?
773-966-5336. My cell number is 773-620-9055. Say, why you do that, lady? Because you need to be able to talk to me. I just ask, like, after 9 o'clock, unless you're dead or on fire, let me rest and take care of my families. But I'm always open to listening. I'm always open to having a conversation. And we are not going to fix this unless we do.
Thank you so much. It's always a pleasure. We're going to have to thank have you. You on again very soon. Okay.
Okay.
All right. Brothers and sisters, thank you so much for tuning in today. On behalf of Alderman Jeanette Taylor of the 20th Ward, the Crow Television production team, and the entire Crow family, I'm your host, Jamil Muhammad. Greeting you and leaving you in the greetings of peace and paradise. Assalamu alaikum.